Welcome to Little House Big Plans with me, Sarah Beeny.
Hi, hello, I'm Sarah.
And award-winning architect Damien Burrows.
Oh, guys.
It's super cool, isn't it?
It's got some impact, that's for sure.
We're going to reveal that no matter how small your home or tight your budget...
Could you not do exactly these stairs, though, the other way around?
Where were you 8 weeks ago?
Sorry about that.
You can create your own grand design.
This is quite some project.
It really is.
Yeah.
For decades, I've been converting small spaces into bigger places.
Believe in yourself.
You were right the first time round.
Absolutely.
But with big plans come big problems.
I'm not sure why you don't turn the house the other way up and have the living space upstairs.
Clever and radical.
After you.
We're meeting those of you brave enough to take on the challenge.
Wow. Oh. That's not a garden, that's like an adult theme park.
Yeah. But will it all be worth it?
It was a moment after we bought it, we thought, have we made the worst decision of our lives?
What was the toughest part for you, Stephen?
Put it up with someone.
Welcome to Little House Big Plans, the show that reveals how to maximise your home on a tight budget. I've come to the idyllic market town of Bosbury in Herefordshire, renowned for its Tudor buildings and beautiful orchards. It's home to psychotherapist Tim, fashion designer Tiff and their daughter Tia. In 2016, they moved from Birmingham to this two-bed small cottage, which they bought for £270,000. They have big plans, not for the cottage, but for its garage.
We've had a really challenging week.
Tim and Tiff hope to convert the garage and rent it out to bring in much-needed income, as COVID has had a huge impact on their careers. So this has all the hallmarks of a tricky renovation with a small space and an even smaller budget.
Hi, I'm Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. How are you? Nice
Welcome.
To meet you.
Thank you. What a beautiful place. How long have you lived here?
It's amazing, Gorgeous. Isn't it? We love it.
We've been here about 5 years.
5 years,
now.
May.
And why did you move here then?
Countryside, peace and quiet.
Yeah, just to get out of the city. Our daughter's, well, she's 14 now, but she was 7. And it just feels a lot safer out of the city. It's just, you know, it's nicer.
And that's your house up there?
It is. Yeah. That's our little cottage. It is, isn't it? It's really cute.
Yeah. And this is what we're converting into a flat.
Okay, so this is the project at the moment, which is converting the garage into...
Rental property.
Rental property.
We'd like to get your advice and see what we can develop.
Brilliant. Let's have a look.
The garage's original layout was two car parking bays downstairs and an office with a bathroom upstairs. The couple's plan is to turn the ground floor into an extended open-plan kitchen living space with a bedroom and an ensuite. Upstairs, they aim to have a second bedroom, again with its own ensuite. And then if there's any money left, above the guest bedroom, they're hoping to build a roof terrace.
So, amazing plans for it.
Big plans, big ideas.
Small budget.
Small budget.
Small budget.
And half a clue.
Perfect.
What could go wrong?
What could go wrong?
There's a lot of will and we need a lot of help. But, yeah, we're very flexible and open on where this is going and what it might look like.
Okay. Definitely Great. Open to some... ideas and your expertise.
We need help.
Definitely.
We all need help.
As a novice, Tim is very much learning as he goes along. But he hopes to complete the job in just 8 weeks. The groundwork has been started and concrete foundations are in place. There's also a temporary staircase. But there's still a long, long way to go.
How much have you got to spend on this then?
So this is being built on a wing and a prayer. Some things in life are. We've got at least 15, could be as much as 25.
This sounds very sinister, this extra budget. Is this like hoping if you dig hard enough, you'll find a pot of gold?
Yeah.
Is that where the extra's coming from?
It's a nest egg that we don't really want to use.
Yeah.
Really what you need to do here is spend as little as you can to get something up and running to then see where it goes and then add to that.
Add to it when we've got the money to do it. Yeah. Right, OK.
Yeah.
We've got three walls up already.
Yeah.
We have an upstairs.
Yeah.
We have a roof.
Yeah.
So we're doing okay so far.
In a bid to keep costs low, Tim has been pulling in favours from all of his friends. But now he's doing most of the work himself.
He's like a one-man band at the moment with everything. He's done so well, so I'm just here to keep him sane because he's just working so hard.
It's a self-build. Really, yeah, Tiff said to me the other day, I'm really enjoying the build. I said, I'm glad you are.
Do you have windows that you've got planned on this floor?
Yes. Here we'll have a window looking out to the Malvern Hills, another window here, and a front door over here. And then we've got a one-storey extension planned here and going out of this door.
This is a lot to do given their small budget.
One of the things that we need some advice on is the staircase. You'll see from our original plans, we were planning a spiral staircase.
We're tricked into thinking a spiral staircase takes up less room. Actually, it takes up much more room than a straight flight of stairs.
And what you can do with a flight of stairs should never be underestimated. If you're on a budget, you can add shelves or cupboards underneath to create valuable storage. They start from £200. If you want to spend a little more cash, why not convert under your stairs into pull-out shelves or drawers to help declutter your home? And it can completely transform the space. If money is no object, then go for a bespoke option. Turning your staircase into a chilled wine cellar. Whilst this isn't the cheapest option, it's great for the wine buffs and will make for fantastic dinner party conversation. Tim and Tiff don't have the money for anything as fancy as that, but they still have a very important decision to make.
There's the question of position of the stairs, and that's one thing we need to ask you.
Okay.
We've already started putting, you know, openings in, yes. in the ceiling.
Well, I think, to be honest, where the stairs go is reliant on where everything else is going.
Yeah.
What they plan to do is convert the garage into a self-contained retreat for young families in need of a break from their city pressures, providing Tim and Tiff with a much-needed income.
That was one of the main reasons we wanted to do it, to offer a sanctuary, shall we say, a small sanctuary for people to come and... Yeah. and
out in the countryside, yeah. a retreat away to get from away from things.
OK, so it's a place to kind of reboot themselves a bit.
Reboot
Tim and Tiff have lots of plans for when this is finished. But it's the plans for the building itself they need to focus on.
Let's have a look upstairs.
Coming up, I turn Tim and Tiff's renovation plans upside down.
So I've got quite a radical idea.
I'm sceptical.
While in Wales, Damien meets a couple who've created the feeling of space in their home by losing space.
This is not what you expect from the outside.
In Bosbury, Herefordshire, Tim and Tiff have started their challenging garage renovation. They hope to create a rental retreat, but with money tight, they need to maximise the income whilst minimising the spend. With Tim doing as much as possible himself to save costs, getting the layout right is absolutely essential.
Let's have a look upstairs.
Great.
Compared to the ground floor level, the first floor's in really good shape.
This is great.
It used to be my office.
So it wasn't such a big leap doing this, in a way. The ground floor was just a garage.
Yes.
But up here, it's been insulated and plastered. And...
Yeah, there's still some questions, you know. What do we do with the toilet space? Is there enough space to fit in a shower, for instance?
When renovating small spaces, it's important that you make the most of what you've got. And that can often mean thinking outside the box.
So I've got quite a radical idea, which you might be a bit horrified.
We like radical
ideas.
Yeah,
we do. I'm all about rock and roll, you know.
Yeah, this is... this is. So when I look at this building, you've got a really big space downstairs, but it's more limited upstairs because of the pitch of the roof. Mm-hmm. You want to have two bedrooms. If you want to rent it out, in a perfect world, you'd have two bedrooms and two bathrooms. Mm-hmm. And mainly what I'm looking at is the amazing view out of those windows.
Stunning, isn't it?
Which is really eye-wateringly amazing.
It makes you just want to breathe.
It really does. It's so it's beautiful of you. I mean, in a perfect world, to make this upstairs work for two bedrooms, you really need to raise the pitches.
So it was suggested by a friend.
But it's expensive,
and we ruled it out on that basis.
And so as a result, I'm not sure why you don't turn the house the other way up and have the living space upstairs, and then you'd have plenty of space downstairs for two bedrooms and two bathrooms.
Very clever.
Clever and radical, yeah.
What do you think?
I think that sounds amazing.
I'm sceptical.
OK, space-wise, it would be better the other way up because you've got more spaces for more bedrooms and bathrooms, and a living space can be one big living space because that's lovely anyway, mm-hmm. and it doesn't matter because everyone wants to live like that now anyway, especially with somewhere like this. You'd have a kitchen, dining, sitting area, which would be amazing. Mm-hmm.
I'm not convinced that Tim's current plans work best for the space. The upstairs would work really well as an open-plan kitchen living space. And downstairs would be plenty big enough for two large double bedrooms with en-suites.
It's a lot of space there, so you could have two bedrooms, two bathrooms and a little cot room slash office. And then all of a sudden, the value of this is...
Far be it from me to challenge the might of Beanie.
You may.
However...
Drop the mic.
However, from here, with the amount of window and that we've got, you can only enjoy the view here when you're standing up in this room.
That is a point. There is an amazing roof light you can get, which turn into balconies. That's a roof light which goes all the way down, and when you open the roof light up, you can push it out and it becomes a balcony.
Good grief. Mm. Another radical idea.
But downstairs is your living space. You're looking at the road, somebody's parking space and someone else's garden.
A lot to think about.
Yes. Sorry about that. Anyway, if you think it's a stupid idea, don't do it.
The current plan has a bedroom on the ground floor and a second on the first floor. Not ideal for a young family. There's another potential issue.
To have a bedroom bathroom upstairs and a bedroom bathroom downstairs.
Ideal.
But, yeah. Well, I'm not sure. I think you want, ideally, you have bedrooms and bathrooms together. You're talking about mother and small child. So you're a mother with a three-year-old. You've got to have a mum upstairs and a three-year-old downstairs.
Good point. Doesn't work, does it?
Not brilliantly.
It's always best to try to keep the bedrooms and bathrooms on the same floor if you possibly can. While Tim and Tiff weigh up my topsy-turvy idea, 55 miles away over the Welsh border, Damien's meeting a couple who threw away the rule book when renovating their small home.
Today I'm in Merthyr Tydfil, an up-and-coming area in Wales that's nestled between the Brecon Beacons and the beautiful rolling valleys.
Merthyr Tydfil is surrounded by beautiful countryside and has great links into nearby metropolitan Cardiff, making it a very desirable post-go to live in. An average detached house sells for around £270,000 here. Merthyr is ideal for young couples like software engineer Rhys and Shannon, who's a nurse. They have a two-year-old daughter, Vita Rose. Rhys and Shannon have transformed their home inside and out.
Hey, Rhys, Shannon, how are you doing?
All well.
Hey, all good, thank you.
Thanks for inviting us along. It's looking very pristine out here. I notice you've bucked the trend along the road. You've gone for a sort of stealth-like graphite grey.
Yes, we wanted to make a little bit of a statement, but keep it subtle as well.
It's definitely to our taste.
Exactly. Well, it's breaking the trend along the road. So if you've done this to the outside, let's have a look at what you've done inside.
Come on in.
Yeah, come on in.
Wanting a family and a forever home, Rhys and Shannon spotted this three-bed detached property in the autumn of 2017, and they bought it for £232,000. On the ground floor, there was a long, thin lounge, a small dining room, kitchen, utility room, and a downstairs loo. Upstairs, there were four bedrooms, a family bathroom, and an ensuite. Rhys and Shannon wanted to modernise this old-fashioned house. The build started in 2018, and around the same time, Shannon fell pregnant. But with their new home, a building site, the couple moved in with relatives. Their three-month project fell behind schedule because of a raft of problems. The builder needed to rethink the foundations, costing an extra £6,000. And when the bifold doors arrived, they didn't fit, pushing the schedule back another 6 weeks. Finally, 9 months after the building had begun, and just weeks before Vita Rose arrived, it was completed. So what does Damien think of their high-tech home?
Oh, this is not what... This is not what you expect from the outside.
I know, it's quite a nice surprise, isn't it?
So. Nice surprise. It looks like a nice, kind of polite, little detached house from the outside. And then you come in here and it's kind of a little bit sort of Miami art gallery. It's got a really lovely feel.
Yeah, this for us is our feature piece, the gallery.
Yeah, this is definitely one of our favourite spots in the house.
It just gives you such a sense of space and air and light. It's all of those things that you wouldn't expect.
The ground floor has been transformed. The open plan living area covers a whopping 80 square metres. There's also a TV room, a study and a shower room to replace the old loo. Rhys and Shannon have achieved this enormous living area by adding a 16-square-metre single-storey extension on the back of their house. By removing 10 square metres of the upper floor, they've created a double-height gallery. The downstairs open-plan living area has a lounge, dining room and kitchen. It enjoys sunlight all day long with the help of large roof lights. The room has superb sight lines, very handy when you have a toddler.
Here's our little darling. Hello, Vita. And she's off again.
Off again. So in and out.
Absolutely. And that's great, actually, because when we open up these doors, the outside connects with the inside.
The house's four bedrooms are now much more stylish. The transformation of this once drab, dated house is clear to see. And it's a far cry from Rhys and Shannon's humble beginnings.
I grew up in a three-bedroom council house with my seven brothers and sisters, and my mother and father, so there was 10 of us there. You were very similar, Shannon, weren't you?
Yeah, very similar. I grew up in a three-bed, semi-detached old council house with five siblings, very crowded house. But, yeah, to have what we have now, I think it makes us appreciate it even more.
You've come from backgrounds much the same as myself, where lots of kids in a small house.
Yeah.
And then you come here and you've opened this place out, and while it may feel like a very open house, there's still something about always being able to see somebody.
Yeah.
Always knowing there's a connection.
This clean, modern home works perfectly for Shannon, Rhys and Vita Rose. But it's the floating mezzanine with glass balustrade that's certainly the focal point.
For us, it's amazing. You know, we've got this sort of viewing platform, this gallery, where it just creates a unique living space for us. Mm. Even though we've lost space, we've gained a lot more.
The design was the brainchild of local architect Stephen George, an old school friend of Rhys.
What a stunning house. Sat out here in the garden, looking back. I mean, you must be pretty chuffed.
I think it was just brave, really.
What was the house like when you first came round the first time?
There was no connection, was there? You had really long corridor-like living rooms, which made everything a lot darker.
Stephen saw that by looking at the house as a whole, he could reclaim unused space.
How do you convince someone to punch a hole through the middle of their house?
The really brave client, right at the beginning, we said, whatever you want, we trust you.
We knew our end goal was to have our dream home, and going through the building site that we used to call home, you know, you have to go through all of that to get, the, you know, the pot of gold at the end.
Dream home, pot of gold.
That's the best part. When people start saying about, you know, about what you've done, that's it. that's what we do it for. Yeah, thank you very much.
Freeing up unused space can transform and add value to your home. If you're on a budget, you can boost bedroom space with a mezzanine bed, which gives you valuable space underneath for desks or a sofa. They're affordable and practical. If you've got a bit more money, you can create mezzanine levels in your home by removing part of a ceiling or floor. And if you really want to push the boat out, why not engineer a floating mezzanine by removing part of the floor above to create a double height living space? Bespoke glass can make this space look even bigger. Rhys and Shannon lost floor space, but did they add value?
So let's talk a little bit about the financial side of it. Mm-hmm. So how much did you buy the house for?
We bought the house for $232,000.
And then what was the final cost of the build? I mean, you've done a lot.
We've spent around 140 and then 35 transforming the dirt into a garden.
That's 370 all in.
There or thereabouts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you sort of kind of think whereabouts it's sitting now?
Value-wise, anywhere between 525 and 550.
I never imagined that this would be our home. We are very proud of what we have achieved.
Absolutely.
And so you should be, and so you should be, because it's a big leap for people to do this. Mm. And for you guys to actually just take floor space out and punch up, what it gives you is amazing, but it goes against the grain of what we think a house is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great. We love it. Absolutely love it.
Yep.
Back in Bosbury, Tim and Tiff are considering turning their garage conversion upside down to make the most of their limited space. If upstairs becomes a living area, they would need to obviously rethink where the kitchen goes.
I mean, the truth is, it is a tiny bit complicated up here because of your sloping roofs. That's the truth of it. But on principle, you need to use your straight walls, so this wall. With a kitchen, you always have to start with the things you have to have, which is the oven, hob, fridge, and sink. They all take up a certain amount of space, so you have to do that. But those are the things you have to have in a kitchen for it to be a functioning kitchen.
And that would all fit in there?
We'd need a little bit of juggling around, but you need to measure it, draw it.
Wow.
You know, and then you would fit it there.
The tiny house revolution is taking off, and Tim and Tiff should embrace it. A fully functional kitchen can be fitted into a surprisingly snug space. If you're on a budget, a campervan kitchen can do the trick nicely. For slightly more money, mini kitchens especially designed for small spaces are available. But as always, do your research to ensure you get the best price. And if you want to go the whole hog, enlist an architect, and they will design you something beautiful, bijou and bespoke. But they don't come cheap.
Principle of the kitchen, when you sort of start planning it, is to go, right, there's a flat wall, that has to be kitchen. Nice. The stairs need to be moved to another place. Yeah. Or the other option is that you have kitchen along here and you have it backing onto the stairs, because you need head height and this isn't enough. And so I always think work with your limitations first and then go, right, well, that's the only option for that.
See, that staircase seems to be taking a lot of room up to me. I'm no expert. Yeah.
Wherever we have a stair
it's
opening,
got to be that wide.
It's going to be taking
really?
Up space.
It is, but it would make more sense to use... This is your restricted head height area here.
Yeah.
When you get to the top of the staircase, you need head height to come up, but you don't need to waste all this head height area with an opening. You need the head height once you get to the top.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Not all the way down.
Sure.
Tim and Tiff had a clear vision for their garage renovation, so trying to get their heads around this radical rethink will take a bit of time.
I mean, you're pretty good because you work very visually. I can't quite see it yet. I'm not fully convinced.
That's probably the only thing I can visualise right now.
Let's go and have a look downstairs.
Coming up, Tim finds it hard to visualise how the new plans could work.
So I'm not sure whether it's a great idea or whether it's a Terrible idea.
Anna, how you doing?
And Damien meets a couple who fell in love with the outside of a small bungalow but hated the inside.
Every time we came into the property and went into the bathroom, I was sick.
In Bosbury, Herefordshire, Tim and Tiff are embarking on an ambitious project to turn their garage into a self-contained two-bedroom rental retreat. But with only a small pot of cash to do it, they're going to have to be really clever with the space and, more importantly, with the budget.
Oh, gosh, look at the view here. That is fantastic.
Isn't it? I thought you were referring to our mud pits.
Well, yes. what's going on here?
Potential swimming pool.
Perfect. Perfect. Is this where the extension's going to be?
Yes, correct. So we're going out 3.5 metres, potentially. Mm-hmm. Potentially.
Because the couple's budget is so limited, they might not be able to afford the extension and the second bedroom straight away. So they need a contingency plan.
So theoretically, you could pour an insulated slab here, mm-hmm. and then just have it as a terrace and then build on it later if you didn't have the money.
Yeah, yeah, that's an idea. So, use it as a usable outside space.
Yeah,
okay. It would mean we'd have a door going to nowhere.
It would. I mean, if you've got the money, I think doing the whole project makes sense. But there's some obvious pause points, and one of the pause points could be after you've poured this, because you can't leave it like that, can you?
No, you can't.
When you're standing here, more than ever, I think turning the house the other way up would be better, because you would see over the top of those trees.
Yes, I get it. But you can't get your head around it, can you, at the moment, hon?
Not yet.
Yeah, we need some serious processing.
Yeah, I'm staying open-minded, because I'm not sure whether it's a great idea and that I'm just struggling to take a leap, or whether it's a terrible idea.
Well, it's taken you 2 years to get your idea around doing this, hasn't it?
Five years.
Oh, OK, 5 years, so maybe a few days.
Yeah. Yes. So I need another 5 years.
It's a lot for Tim to take in. However, making the most of the square footage will increase the value of the property. But more importantly, it will maximise the potential rental income.
What are you doing for a job at the moment?
Since COVID, our financial situation has, you know, monthly income has halved, literally. So things have really, really changed for us.
So in some ways, because your income has been affected, actually, this little project is quite a lifeline in a way.
It's going to provide a lifeline. Once we start getting some revenue from rental, then that's going to make a huge difference.
And with that in mind, it's time to move on to the plans and see if Tim would reconsider drafting them.
So originally, we were thinking dining room with a bathroom and cloakroom and a bedroom upstairs with a roof terrace.
So you're thinking leave that wall in place and then go through the bedroom to the garden?
Yes, which I get doesn't quite make sense.
Not
That's
quite.
The bit that I hadn't thought, it hadn't occurred to me, that part. So, okay.
Yeah. So actually, so what I'm really talking about is you'd move the stairs here and then kitchen units here, which you'd be able to fit. And that would be your living space. And then downstairs, I mean, there's certainly enough room here to have two bedrooms and two bathrooms and probably a little office / make the office big enough to be able to put a pair of bunk beds in it. So then...
Yeah. Even without taking out this wall?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
There's plenty of room. So I don't think the costs are going to be dramatically different whichever way up it happens.
No.
It's just a question of you deciding whether you're going to do it or not.
Mm. Yeah.
OK.
I feel a little bit sorry for Tim and Tiff, because I have definitely thrown all their plans up in the air today. But the reality is it makes more financial sense to change their plans completely. The question is, will they be brave enough to actually do that? At the moment, I fear not. Whilst Tim and Tiff mull over changing their plans,
Damien's in Devon to meet a family who have completed their big plans and transformed their once small home without the help of an architect.
I'm here in Elberton to meet a couple who fell in love with a view, and they quite literally turned the house around to capture it.
Elberton is a suburb near Plymouth. It's a commuter town with excellent links to some of the finest unspoilt coastline in the UK. Houses here are much sought after, with a current average price of around £300,000. Elberton residents Mike and Emma have two children, Darcy, aged 9, and William, 7. They bought this three-bed detached bungalow in 2013 for £181,000, and they've totally transformed it.
Hey, Mike, Anna, how you doing?
Hi.
Thank
good.
You.
Yeah, good to meet you.
And you? Yeah.
Yeah, I love a bungalow.
Yeah, it is nice. It's nice to have everything all on one level.
Isn't it, Jess?
You don't have to have stairs to climb or anything like that.
I can see yours looks quite different from the neighbours, so you've clearly done quite a bit of work.
Yes.
I mean, looking at what it was to how it is, can't wait to actually get inside and see what you've done.
Fantastic. Yeah.
Come,
right,
on,
let's
come on in.
Lead the way.
When they moved into the bungalow, the layout was all wrong. The lounge was at the front of the house, looking onto a steeply raised lawn, and there was hardly any natural light coming into the kitchen. The wonderful views of the garden and surrounding countryside were wasted. The bungalow hadn't had any work done on it for years. The kitchen was full of dowdy brown cupboards and old tiling. The bedroom was dated and the other rooms dark and dingy. So Emma and Mike began a 7-year project to make their dream home. In 3 major stages, they reconfigured the rooms in the bungalow to free up more internal space and make better use of the garden and amazing views. They've had not one but 2 extensions to create a modern, clean yet cosy vibe. It's time for Damien to see if all that hard work paid off.
Oh, this is lovely.
Thank you very much.
It's so light, and it's when you look at the house from the front, you look at it as small bungalow, roof set down as well, you think it's going to be really dark. But as soon as you come through this door, I can see why you fell in love with this place.
Yeah.
But it wasn't love at first sight. When they moved in, Emma had just fallen pregnant, and the green bathroom would set off her morning sickness.
Every time we came into the property and went into the bathroom, I was sick.
She couldn't come in the house. She had to walk in with a scarf over her face to get to the bedroom before she could actually relax.
As well as a different coloured bathroom, Mike and Emma wanted an open-plan home which they designed themselves.
We thought we can really maximise this space, so, yeah.
And you certainly have. There's no doubt about that. I mean, the light's just pouring in. I love the little dining area over there as well. Got views out in this direction. I mean, this has been very carefully thought through.
One-floor living used to be associated with the elderly in this country, but bungalow renovations are having a renaissance thanks to visionaries like Mike and Emma.
It helped because Mike's very creative, so he was like, look, this is what we can do, we can, you know, reverse these rooms, we can do this, and it just kind of, I've got good vision, so I can see, yeah, actually, this could be really nice.
Their design turned the bungalow's rooms around. At the front, the old living room has been partitioned to make 2 bedrooms. At the back, the 2 bedrooms have been knocked through to make a new garden-facing living area. The garage has been converted into an office for Mike, and the extension at the back has added an extra playroom for the kids.
Deciding to effectively pick your whole house up and turn it round through 180 degrees while you've got a young son and a young daughter, that's a lot to take on.
The final piece of the jigsaw is a side extension to enlarge the open-plan kitchen and make William's bedroom even bigger. But it wasn't an easy build.
We were let down massively by a building company, so it then got rearranged with some new builders to start in the January. Obviously, completely unaware that COVID was going to hit and it was going to become a bit of a nightmare.
The pandemic led to delays in supplies, but things were about to get much worse. 5-year-old William had become seriously ill and was rushed into hospital for scans. Mike and Emma got the news that every parent dreads.
He had a tumour in his tummy. As you can imagine, the world then just turns upside down. The build takes a second. Everything took a step back.
William had to have emergency surgery to remove the tumour.
Luckily, we had the operation. Everything was fine.
It was all right.
4 weeks later, we got the call to say that it was benign. So it was fine. He was just on the road to recovery. So at that point, I had to come back.
To put everything into perspective, though, didn't it?
Totally.
You know, because you kind of, when you're doing a renovation, everything, you kind of become a bit blinkered to everything, and then something like that happens, and it just brings you straight back down to earth, and just kind of you just think, do you know what, none of this really matters at the end of the day, as long as we're all healthy.
The renovation was finally completed last year. The 7-year project that started with a DIY redesign and the demolition of most of the interior ended with the ceremonial unveiling of these windows.
As soon as those windows came in and the sun just flooding, it was amazing.
The open plan kitchen is now the heart of the home.
We're just together, we're one unit now rather than all dotted around the place.
And, you know, I'd be quite happy cooking there, having a look at that view. How many things have you burned by getting a little bit captivated in the middle distance?
No, burning is me.
Oh, burning
is
you.
Yeah, that's your job, yeah.
Emma and Mike's kitchen, with its enormous island, is a triumph. It's helped them dramatically transform a small, old-fashioned bungalow into a state-of-the-art, spacious family home. The cost of the 7-year project was £90,000.
You've got a lot of house for 90 grand.
Yeah, recycling a lot of things to keep the cost down. Yeah.
I mean, you can't emphasise that enough, can you? Taking the doors from here, reusing them in the bedroom, reusing the kitchen.
Yeah.
You don't have to throw everything away. In fact, it's the worst thing to do.
Mm. With the original purchase price of £181,000, the total investment from Mike and Emma has been £271,000.
What do you think the resale value might be right now?
We've just had
it one recently, didn't we?
Revalued for mortgage purposes at £410,000.
£410,000, wow. So you've got £140,000 profit for the work that you've put in here.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, good job.
It's been a tough journey for Mike and Emma for all kinds of reasons, but views like this make it all worthwhile.
Looking back at the house, you must feel incredibly proud of what you've achieved.
Yeah.
It's been a long slog, but our dreams have become reality. As cheesy as that sounds, that is exactly what's happened, you know. All those years ago, we sat in the garden thinking, yeah, we could do this, we could do that, and we've actually gone ahead and done it, and, yeah, we've no regrets at all.
Well, I think you've put enough work into this for now just to be able to sit back in this spot, overlooking the hills, and just enjoy it.
Yeah, that's exactly what we're going to do.
Mike and Emma have taken an ugly duckling and they've transformed it into this beautiful white swan. They've created intrigue, drama, theatre and flair, all behind its unassuming frontage. But once you step across that threshold, it's pretty clear to see why they fell in love with this plot.
Coming up, I return to Tiff and Tim.
So I've got quite a radical idea.
And we'll find out if they've swapped their upstairs for their downstairs.
I'm sceptical.
Or they've stuck with their original plans.
OK.
I'm in Herefordshire to visit Tim and Tiff. Having moved from bustling Birmingham 5 years ago to escape to this secluded 3-bedroom cottage, their big plan was to convert their double garage at the end of their drive into a rental property. Tim and Tiff ploughed all their savings into buying this house and land for £425,000. In order to keep costs low, Tim had to take on most of the work himself. The couple's big ambition was to convert their 2-car garage into a 2-bedroom dwelling. On the ground floor, there was going to be a guest room with ensuite and an open-plan kitchen diner. upstairs there was going to be another guest room with an ensuite and a balcony.
I'm back in the pretty village of Bosbury in Herefordshire to see Tim and Tiff, who, when I first met them, had big plans for their small garage.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, Sarah, welcome back.
Judging from the outside, things haven't quite moved forward as much as you might have liked them to.
Not quite worked out the way we had planned when we saw you last.
OK, let's go and see what else has been going on.
OK.
So the great reveal.
So the big reveal, Sarah.
Drum roll.
The big reveal.
Gosh, I'm here speechless. Yeah. I mean, that is exactly the same.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So nothing has happened?
Nothing has happened on the build. A lot has happened in life.
Okay.
A lot of decisions, a lot of life challenges.
So what's been the biggest complication of the last 6 months?
Getting workmen out to even quote, yeah, let alone do
committing
the work.
Committing to anything.
When I first met Tiff and Tim, we talked about a whole new layout.
I'm not sure why you don't turn the house the other way up and have the living space upstairs. And then you'd have plenty of space downstairs for two bedrooms and two bathrooms. What do you think?
I'm sceptical.
Their original plans were to have a bedroom downstairs with an ensuite plus an open-plan kitchen-diner. And then upstairs there was a second bedroom also with an ensuite plus a roof terrace. The new plan was to invert the whole layout, with the ground floor being bedrooms and bathrooms, and the first floor taking advantage of the reduced head height, being open plan living and a roof terrace.
So whilst this all looks exactly the same, mm-hmm, you did have plans to have it as a ground floor living space, and
yeah,
we talked about maybe turning all your plans upside down and having this as bedrooms. Have you thought more about that?
Yes.
We have.
Yeah. This has really evolved as an idea and through our thinking for over 5 years.
Yeah.
So I guess when you've been thinking about it that long, it can be very difficult to let go of some decisions and plans that you've got and go in a different direction. But that is what we've got to do.
Yeah.
And we've gone with your plans for turning it upside down.
Great!
Yeah.
That's very exciting.
And of course, it makes it more multi-purpose for what we imagine
our
it
dream
to be.
To be, yeah. Yeah.
Basically, it was a great idea, Sarah, and we've
yeah,
gone with
was.
That.
Oh, I knew it would have been. I'm going to record that on my phone. Hang on a minute.
Yeah.
And so upstairs, anything changed or has it just kind of been abandoned?
Should we go and have a look?
Yeah, let's
come on then. Let's go and look. So pretty much the same up here. Have you used this at all?
We've been using it as a storage space.
Talk to me about your plans, because we talked about moving the stairs to here and then having a turn to keep the head tight.
Mm-hmm. Exactly that. Stairs popping up here the kitchenette here, which leaves this area as living space and viewing.
Lovely.
Space. Yeah, exactly that.
It's going to be
fabulous, isn't it? Yeah. It's exciting.
And I know that budget's really tight on this.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's getting tighter. Last time we spoke to you, we were talking about our budget, 15,000 to 25,000, but that was as a self-build. One of our key learnings has been that all the contractors, they're so busy and they can pick and choose their work at the moment. That has made it really difficult to contract anybody for small parts of the build. Mm. They want to maximise their profits and they would rather have the whole build or charge a lot for small parts.
Yeah.
And that would make it very, very
so
expensive either way.
So we've gone with the whole build.
Great. So new plans all round, a new way of doing it, and everything's new.
New plans, yeah, new approach, new budget, which we need to talk about. And yeah, let's go and show you what we've got.
Brilliant.
Have a cup of tea.
These are the drawings. Gorgeous. That is fantastic.
Yeah. Doesn't it look great?
What I would really consider is moving this bathroom out to where the cloakroom is here so that you had access to it from this area here, because what you really want is the flexibility of being able to use all of this, but these two bedrooms sharing one bathroom.
You definitely want a minimal viable product with this because of your budget. You just need to get it up and running. So you were hoping to spend no more than 25,000. Where are you going to find the other 25,000?
Really? We don't know. We're going to have to take out a loan, I think.
Mm. Didn't really want to do that, but I think
realistically,
yeah, we'll have to.
But the reality is that as a one bed, it would have rented for maybe £350 mm-hmm. a month. And yeah. as a two bed, it's more likely to be more like 700, so mm-hmm. double
That's
the
right.
amount.
Yeah. That's right.
When it comes to selling, if you ever sold, it would definitely stack up.
Yeah.
And in the short term, it does give an income as well. I've got to be honest, I do think you've made the right decision for the space. I don't think you'll regret
That's
it.
Good to know.
Very excited to see the end result.
Me too.
Back to cut the ribbons.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm thinking. Tim and Tiff have had a really rough ride. They've had to change their plans, double their budget, but now finally they're about to be underway. And I'm sure that this will give them the financial security they crave for. In this series, Damien and I have celebrated those of you brave enough to transform your little homes. The plans have been big, bold, and audacious. Where the traditional and contemporary combine, bricks have been replaced with glass, walls have been knocked down to create light, airy spaces, and the boundaries between the outside and the in have been blurred. But one thing that all these homes have in common is they're designed to work for the people that live in them.
Well, more brick and mortar makeovers with George Clark, transforming left behind buildings into future-proofed family homes. Stream the series so far on all four. Well, that was the last in the series from Sarah. This time next week, Supervet will be back, trying to save a police dog from being forced off the force. But next tonight, inside the virus factory, as the undeclared war rages on.